Hello and welcome to this video in which I want to showcase my hand tracking setup. I have to decided to include the hand tracking through a document imaging camera into my videos so that you can see the same things and have the same information about the game as I have when playing the game. First of all, what is hand tracking? Hand tracking is basically tracking what is in your opponent's hand, which cards they have, and this is not really something you can do in paper magic, for example in MTG, but it's a thing in both Hearthstone, where there's actual apps for it that show you this card was drawn in turn 1, turn 2, etc. But it's also a thing in Legends of Runeterra. As for the basic setup, we have these two champions over here. I just really like seeing what my opponent's champions are without having to click on the deck all of the time. And also seeing how close they are to leveling up. For that purpose, I would just put a dice on it. For example, Zoe levels up at 10. Like 6 out of 10, I would put a 6 on it. And I can actually look over and just see, oh, 6 out of 10, 7 out of 10. And for me, this is less tedious than just having to click on the deck all the time. For the hand tracking, these are just normal bicycle cards. And this pile, of course, symbolizes the deck, and these are the cards in my opponent's hand. And I want to just jump into a custom game here with my phone to explain to you how this hand tracking works in the game. For that, we switch over to this view, and you might already notice the hand tracking in my top right of my screen. I will put it next to my opponent's hand. First, you should keep track of your opponent's cards here, because you can actually see what they are mulliganing. And in our case, pay close attention now, you can see that they have mulliganed those two cards. You can only see those if you kept those two cards. You can only see this if you pay close attention, and it only shows it to you when you mulligan yourself. So I will play one of these cards I kept in my hand. It's this one and this one. And pay close attention that this one is what I kept, and I will just play Zoe now. Similarly, let's just pass here and let this Zoe hit us. So this means they generate a face-up card in their hand called the Super Cool Star Chart. And whenever there's a face-up card, I just turn over one of these bicycle cards. I didn't make any custom cards for face-up cards because that would like be way too much work. So once they actually play this card to invoke one, then it actually goes face down. Just pick a random one here. And let's pass twice because you will notice like, this card symbolizes the invoke more or less, basically a star chart drawing. If you look at the hand now, you might notice that they have this one card sticking out. Every card is under the right card, it's like from right to left order, but this one card is sticking out. And the reason for that is because this one card is actually the invoke card. So take a look at this, I will just play this card, this invoke card, and you saw it went from over here to battlefield, also leveling up my Zoe. So, another example for this, let's just pass here, and I will now play another card that creates a card, which is the Solari Priestess, and again, I will track this in my opponent's hand, 6 normal cards and 1 rogue card, and let's just pass a bit. So you will see now that again this one invoke card is standing out, And you can even track my hand with this. For example, if I asked you, which card did I just play? You see, I played this invoke card last turn, and it came from the left side, so I actually played this from the left side. Now I have two invoke cards in my hand over here. And to showcase this, let's pass one turn. We'll play one of these invoke cards now, that you can know. I'm not lying to you. This one is the Falling Comet. The other one would be a Star Chart. Another Star Chart, a Golden Sisters. And I will just discard this with a Rummage to show you. So yeah, see how this is always working. Left. Alright, side. Now, these champions, what do they mean? Look at the Zoe, it's 5 out of 10. So I would just put a 5 over here. And once I kill a Zoe, with this Pokestick, then I would remove those because it didn't track that anymore. And would put down a 1 over here. In Constructed, you can almost always guess that they have a 3-on-3 split. So once I killed 2 or 3, I would turn this over, which means that the champion has actually died. But so much for showing that hand tracking actually is a thing. Now let's switch over to actual screen. Large. Talk a little bit more on how my system works exactly. Once again, I have these different dice, I have like 20 dice and these very beautiful tiger eye dice. I like holding them in hand, utilizing them for stuff. So this is like my primary reason, I just want to play with these dice. I have like those quartz dice over here and white ones. And an excellent example for the system with the champions would be the Viger champion. Viger levels up by damaging or dealing damage with darkness, so I would keep track over here on how much damage I dealt with darkness. If I kill a Viger, I would put this gray die on it, and I actually want to keep track of the number of darkness stacks they have. So if like Viger stays on board, the darkness stack goes up to 1, so I would use this brown tiger eye die to show that they have like stacks so that the darkness deals 5 damage. If Viger ever flips, I would remove this level up die and flip him over like this, so I know that the Viger is flipped. If I killed all 3 of them, I would actually turn this over. As for the other cards, I just like normally add, start with 4 cards in my hand, and then I just add those cards to the hand whenever they draw them. And just remove random cards normally. I don't like keeping track of where each card is in each hand, because then you just have to stare at the screen continuously, and this is like very exhausting if you do that for a longer period of time. If you have like an anchor card in the hand, if you have like invoked ones, then it's easier to tell if the card is a top decked card, because if the hand looks like this afterwards, you know it was top decked. If the hand looks like this, you know they didn't play their top decked card yet. Okay, so let's talk about hand tracking in general. Is it necessary to do it? Definitely not. It's a pretty advanced skill, and I know of few people who actually do it, except for like tournaments. Normal play, most people just like play and experience the game that way. For me, it's actually fun to keep track of the hand. I'm always like having cards in my hand and playing with them whenever I play a card game. It's like something I really missed when playing online. CCGs or CCGs, and having this hand tracking, having these cards in my hand. I'm a MTG shuffler. I used to play the MTG a lot and had to always shuffle cards in my hand when I was playing. So this was something I was missing with lore, and this hand tracking is just really fun for me. If you are a new player, if you are a beginner, I wouldn't worry about this stuff at all. But if you are more advanced, if you like Platinum Plus, want to break through to masters, and it's a really useful skill to have. I have a very competitive mindset, And Ballista from Terror is a game of limited information, and you don't have perfect information like in games with chess, for example. You always make educated guesses for your play, and knowing what your opponent's hand looks like can often be of an advantage. For example, let's say you think about whether you open attack or not, and they have three cards in their hand. You might be like, I don't know, they could have like a judgment, they could have other spells that could deal with me. But if you know, if you keep track of your opponent's hand and you know that they have like only those three cards, like one invoke from 4, 5, 6, another invoke and a dragon, then you would know, of course, the dragon can't be cast at burst speed and all the invokes are slow, so you are free to open attack. Similarly, if they hold one card in the hand for a very long time, they kept this card, for example, and don't play it at all, this oftentimes means it's a champion they want to play. Especially beginners or newer players to expeditions tend to keep their champions at all cost. So if they have like a 5-cost champion and don't play it for a while, then you would guess that it's a champion. And this small pieces of information just help you piece together what the opponent can do and can't do. And another thing is if you know, like from combat, they don't have a combat trick, and it's like this, and you know that those four cards are not combat tricks, next turn they draw a card and play this card from the hand immediately, then you know they still don't have any combat tricks in their hand. So that's how it's useful, and it can help you improve. But once again, if you are like a beginner expedition player, or if you are like below platinum in constructed, I wouldn't worry about it at all. One thing I would do is like have a random drawing for this invoke, for example, and just keep track of how many invokes they have in their hand. Because this is like fundamental information you always should know, because Targon's removal spells are locked behind invokes. Generally, you can either write down, like they have a dragon in hand, for example, might be an interesting information, or have like three telescope cards in hand. But in general, I wouldn't worry too much about it. You can certainly go to Masters without hand tracking, and you can certainly go Infinite Expeditions without it. It's just another asset, another tool that can help you get better at the game. Now I want to take a look at the different regions and which effects are actually affected by hand tracking. Let's switch over to Action View. I have this screen a little bit larger, but I should still also want to show you the cards I'm talking about and go through them region by region. Which cards do I keep track of and which cards are like less relevant? Let's start off with Bandle City, and I won't showcase all of the different champions I drew. You have to watch the videos, otherwise this video would take like a ton of time. But in Bandle City, the first face down card to keep track of would be Model Squire, generating this tiny spear or tiny shield. And I just drew like this spear and shield to track of that. Next effect that's like face down would be the Loping Telescope, and I have drawn telescope for that. Then we have the Ontologist, manifesting a spell from your regions. As for the spells, I usually use the magic tokens for energy, like lightning, because like lightning makes sense for me spell. I ran out of those, so for Bandle City, which is green by the way, because I only have so many yellow sleeves, and this is like kinda green, and I didn't want to make three regions yellow, so Bandle City is green. But for these spells, if I take a Contrologist, I would put a 3 on it, that's why I know it's a spell that costs 3 or less. And if you like know their hand is like 2 Contrologist spells, you can definitely rule out some of the cards. If you know they don't have any Contrologist spells in their hand, you know that you don't have to play around random stuff, only around stuff they actually have in their hands. The next one to keep track of, and the last one for Bandle City, is the Bandle City Mayor. This one generates a random multi-region follower, and I just have this like Bandle symbol drawn for the multi-region. And another last card for the constructed players is the Bandle Tree. I tend to put this one over here and just keep track of over here and keep track of my opponent's battle tree progression and my own battle tree progression. For example, if I play an Arena Kingpin, not really a card in Battle City, but it's just like someone I found. And I would put a dice here and here so that I have already Noxus and this one. And eventually, if I have like dice and all of these, then I would know which regions am I missing, even without having Battle Tree in hand or Battle Tree on the board. For my opponent, I would do the same thing, but with different dice. For example, in the mirror, I would use these gray dice and keep track of my opponent's Battle Tree progression like this, for example. And then we would know who is like faster in progressing the Battle Tree. Like really helpful. I don't really like the Battle Tree UI. Showcase this card really quickly. Tree. It only shows you which regions you already completed, but not the ones that are missing. So you would basically have to count each time. And I found this really tedious when playing the deck. Especially you need to know already which regions you're missing, which regions you have already, because you have to plan this in with playing like Battle City Mayor so that you can complete your wincon. So I just drew this different, this small chart, and if you want to play Battle Tree or have problems against the deck, I would advise you to do the same. Other created cards are created face up, for example the Babbling Balladeers. I would, if I generate an Owlcat, I would just put a face up card here signalizing that they have an Owlcat in. This includes Battle City. Let's move on to Bilgewater. And Bilgewater actually has a lot of effects you can keep track of. The first one I want to talk about is Nautilus and Deep. Never play against Deep. It's very important to know when they are Deep. And what I do is I actually put like two dice top of the deck, like this, and just keep basically track of how close they are in the Deep. You can actually draw a card from the middle here and reduce the number. And once they are Deep, you can just remove those dice. But against Nautilus, it's very important to actually keep track. You can also put this on Nautilus, for example. I generally just like to know how many cards they have in the deck. It's Bilgewater, especially if they play any sea monsters down. Okay, the next thing to keep track of would be the spells once again. There are two different spell generators. First off, you have the Coral Creatures. This one generates a random 1-cost spell in your hand. I would put a 1 on this spell symbol. Malarily, Sep's Brayfin generates draws a spell from your deck that costs 3 or less. And I would just put a this one just to keep track of which one they have. For example, if you know they have a spell with 3 or less and you play against Old Bendel, not Old Bendel Burn, Old Pirate Burn, you would know they only have a Noxious Fervor in hand. Basically have one face up card this way. Another important effect to keep track of is Nabbing. Nabbing gives them access to the cards in your own deck. So you have to play around different regions, you have to play around your own deck, not only around their regions, and it's really important to keep track of how many cards they have nabbed from your deck. Oftentimes it's like 2, and once they play the nabbed cards, you can remove. This is actually the reason as well why I make all of my decks prismatic. Gives you a competitive advantage since you will see if your opponent doesn't have his deck prismatic, you will see which cards they nabbed from you if you randomly are playing the same regions, because your cards will be prismatic and theirs won't. Next one would be the treasures. For example, Shipwreck Hoarder and Lost Witches generate treasures. It's like a little bit more fringe, but I would put down this treasure and just like I use these white ones as numbers. So I would say they play the Shipwreck Hoarder, they now have two treasures in their deck. Play one, I would put it down to 1. Then the card if they played both of these. Another very important thing, like this is one of the most important things for hand tracking, would be Lurk. And you can really, really play way better against Lurk if you keep track of the hand and which resources they have. Talk about this with the Pike spell. So Pike and Rek'Sai show up on your top of the deck. Like, don't see this Pike animation of transforming into death from below, but you do see the Rek'Sai animation over here. And whenever a card with Lurk is on top of the deck, I always put this Lurker on top. Then I can actually see which cards they have in their hand. And Lurk oftentimes goes lower on cards. If you know they only have Lurkers in their hand, then you know they can't really interact with you. If you know they have one non-Lurk card in their hand because they missed Lurk, for example, then you know you have to play around Boneskewer and Ruthless Predator. And this is like a big, big advantage. For example, if they have a Rek'Sai on top, then I put Rek'Sai on top. If they then play Bloodbait to conserve this Rek'Sai on the top, I would put another Lurk on top of it. Then I would know they have another Rek'Sai on the top, and then I can just, for example, play Aloof Travelers, make them draw this, and discard the random Lurker. And I would definitely advise you, if you ever want to try this out, try hand tracking against Lurk. It's like really, really relevant information. Lurk only plays four different non-Lurk spells: Boneskewer, the random minions, and Ruthless Predator. So if you know they didn't hit Lurk and they don't play this card out, then you know immediately that it has to be one of these two spells, and you can play around that. So yeah, hand tracking really important against Lurk. It's also like deck tracking. If I know they have like Rek'Sai on top, I put Rek'Sai on top. And I tend to keep tracks of the Lurk stacks by just putting a dice on Rek'Sai. So if they Lurk like four times, I will put a four on it. There's no real way to keep track of like Pike because the animation doesn't show for you. You don't have to carefully pay attention to the top of the deck time. Okay, this covers Lurk. Most important card would be like Bloodbait. Play this card, you immediately know have a Bloodbait Snapchat Swarm on the top of the deck. You want to prepare accordingly that they play it next turn. Just forget about it. Might be surprised, but. And the last one that's like really relevant are Sea Monsters. Those for now. The Chol Hunters card creates random Sea Monsters in your hand. And I just drew some random Sea Monsters here to symbolize those. Don't judge my drawing, it's just like for fun. I don't like want to spend 5 hours on each one of them. Okay, this covers Bilgewater. Let's move on to Demacia. Demacia only has three effects to keep track of. First one would be Investigator. The Investigator, called Mage Seeker, Preserver or Conservator. Yes, this card. And I again put a spell down, like this lightning one. It has like white borders for Demacia. And put a 6 on it, so I know it's like a 6 cost spell. Next one of the 10 favorites in Expeditions, is the Egghead Researcher. Creating a random dragon in hand, intended to run out of dragons, so I have like a ton of MTG tokens here, which symbolize random dragons. I would just put them down here whenever they have a dragon in their hand. So can't draw the dragons that well. And the last card in Demacia would be Driftwing Dancer. One creates a random elite in hand. So I have like these judge tokens from MTG that are basically random soldiers. And I use those random soldiers to symbolize an elite in the hand. Shiny, like most of these are. And yeah, this already covers Demacia. Only three cards that generate other cards. I guess actually, now that I think about it, we have this Swiftwing. How is it called? Laura. Or Chevalier. I tend to never see this card. Nobody plays this card ever. But let's actually draw like a Challenger symbol. That we have this one covered as well. So for the Laura and Chevalier in the future, we will just use like this Challenger symbol. We draw this more beautifully, but just as a reference in the video. Like this. So this one would symbolize the Laura Chevalier, and I didn't use this like ever or need this ever because I see this card so rarely and it strikes so rarely, but I will. I just noticed from the other video. Okay, the Master covered, and next up is Freljord. Freljord, first of all, has the champions, and either draw a champion with card and tomb, another tomb and treat, or a champion, and the Howling Abyss generates random champions in the hand. For me, champions always are like monarchs or like the special cards, so I like this monarch token. This means champion, and if they ever have like more than two champions in the hand, I just tend to use dice as well. Have Howling Abyss on the board and don't play anything for 5 turns or something. Now they have 5 monarch tokens or 5 champions in the hand, and there is. Okay, the next card to keep track of are Yetis. I wouldn't keep track of Yeti Yearling, but Avarotian Trapper is very important. I have this Yeti token over here, and I would just... Avarotian Trapper, you know it's in the top 3 cards of the deck, so I would say it's like 1 Yeti, and then I would count down. First turn they draw it, they didn't play it. Second draw, they didn't play it. When this number goes to 3, I can safely move it to their hand, because then it's like known information they have a Yeti in hand, but just didn't play it yet. Again, this is very important. You know that they will draw a Yeti in a certain turn. We had this with Missial, and just keep track of how many cards they have, how many Yetis. It's very likely that they will draw the Yeti, and it was like that they just had a Yeti this critical turn. And this is like a nice action. And the next one, please don't judge me for that, I tried drawing those multiple times, but it's failed. Pogos, and Lonely Pogo generates a random Pogo in the hand, and this is how like I drew these Pogos, and I guess we can give them like horns and stuff, maybe I redraw those at some point, but it's not really an effect that comes up too often. We also have our Purealis generating random Pogos in their hand. Something to keep in mind, but not something that comes up all that often. Somehow really bad at drawing Pogos. This covers Freljord, and Ionia actually only has one singular card that you have to kind of keep track of. All the other cards that generate are face up. For example, if you think of Scales of the Dragon, this card, the Dragon's Protection, is face up, so you don't have to have a card for it necessarily. The only card that's different is Karma. Karma generates a random spell from your regions. I have like this purple spell sleeve. Just tend to keep track of how many Karma spells they have in the hand. 3, 5. Other one, this is the count. 5, 4, 5, for example, if they have like come on the board for a very long time. It's very important to click on the cards very quickly because you can actually see if a card is created or not clicking on the card. Okay, Ionia pretty quickly. Then we have Noxus. Noxus has only 2 effects we have to keep track of. The first one, like I used to keep track of the reputation of the 5. You can do that, but I don't. I have found out that reputation like rarely matters at all. Position 6 for example, because all of these effects, like, doesn't really matter if they cost 4 or 1 or 4 or 2 in the late game. I just didn't keep track of reputation more. First created card is the Crimson Curator. Whenever I survive damage, create a Crimson Follower in hand. I have like these blood cards for symbolizing the Crimson Follower. That's properly. This just stands for Crimson Follower. Rarely comes up, but if it comes up, we are prepared. One important one would be Riven and the Blade Fragments. I think a big problem people have playing against Riven is that they misunderstand how far they are ahead. Oftentimes you see a Riven with like 5 cards in hand and you are like, oh my god, I only have 2 in my hand, I am totally losing. But then they just have random blade fragments in their hand. Put some effort into drawing these blade fragments. So they're like not exclusive, I just wanted to draw different images. And what happens with these blade fragments, if you have generated the first one, then you like the +2/+0 one, then you will generate the other two in order. They play a +2/+0 blade fragment, then you can like actually count this one out. I have different cards for that. I would put down Riven as a champion, Riven blade, and then I would just put on top of Riven, like this one, they played the +2 already, played the quick attack already, so I know they generate another one. This has to be overwhelm one. Then after they played the third, I would just remove those and track of the blade fragments and do. But it just starts randomly again. Oftentimes it's very deceptive with Riven, how far you are ahead. They oftentimes have like a ton of blade fragments in their hand, but no real cards. So if you shut down the Riven, if you shut down the blade, you oftentimes win. This is like another thing I would advise you to keep doing. You face against Riven, you play Expeditions. It's becoming a thing in Constructed with Pantheon. Then you definitely keep track of how many fragments they have in their hand. Okay, Nox is down. Let's move to Piltover and Zorn. So PNC has a variety of effects as well. Let's start with Trail of Evidence. Trail of Evidence will oftentimes just get played immediately. Creates a random 2-cost card from your regions, and I just have a card that has a 2 written on it for the Trail of Evidence. Next one, again, a pretty corner case, playing like more of labs. It's Calculated Creations, that is creating one of these random augment units in your hand. And I just have like a card where like it's drawn a augment symbol on it. And I know that they have one of the created cards. Again, not very important. Then we have the Eminent Benefactor. This one creates a random epic card from your regions in your hand. This is like a little bit more relevant in Expeditions because you have this bucket system. So you don't really play around, I at least don't really play around random epics from other buckets. But if you know they have like an epic card in their hand, then you can play around it more easily. Okay. Another very important one would be Death Ray, probably not in Constructed, but in Expeditions. For Death Ray, you can perfectly track again. For Death Ray, I would put a number here for the strength. Played Death Ray number 1, turns into number 2. And then once again, I would count down. First draw, second draw, and then third draw. And on the third draw, if I didn't play it by now, I would move it into their hand. This way, you might see this in the next expedition run I upload today. That I actually know exactly when they have Death Rays in their hand. Like a little bit more important than the Yetis, because Yetis will oftentimes just be played, but Death Rays they will keep in their hand, and it's a little bit definitely the mistake you can avoid to be hit by a Death Ray you know about. And the last face down card is the Back Alley Barkeep. This one creates a random card from your regions, and I just have like this bottle drawn here, which symbolizes this one. And I know there's another card, the University of Piltover, but if they play University, they have one real card and 3 created cards. Not really that important. They just like put 3 cards down here and one like this. And another thing about Fleeting, let's say they have a Pool Shark. And whenever they have a Fleeting card, I tend to just put like this, one like this, so that I remember at the start of the next turn. And I put the Fleeting card a little bit more up. And this symbolizes for me that they have a Fleeting card in their hand. Another thing I can show you is the hand and deck buffs. So if you have, for example, the shared spoils. This one, grant the top 3 units in your deck +1/+1. I would put down 3 +1/+1 counters over here next to the deck to know that there are like 3 units coming that are buffed. Similarly, if they have like a Starlit Seer, and they keep playing spells, I would put the 20 and just keep track of how much this top unit is buffed, for example 5 times, 6 times, etc. So you're not like surprised by how big the unit can be surprised, but it's just something you can easily avoid. Similarly with hand buffs, for example, we have the Old Man, the Elder, Kingblade Elder. And what I do here is I put a dice on all the cards affected, and then I keep close track of what their card is. Of course, if they play like a unit that isn't like affected, then you can discard. And then I make like two piles, these like buffed once, like buffed twice. One time I played against three greenlit elders, where it went like really complicated. We had like one card with three buffs, those two with two buffs, and this one with one buff, etc. And I have to keep closer track of which card of those they play. If they play this card as a spell, then you're like happy that they don't get this buff. And I do the same thing with the other Ionian card. Just forgot the name, Shield Protector. If they play a Shield Protector, you can actually see by the animation which card they're hitting with it. I would just put a that. You can do the same with like the barrier one, like the Guardian, but that rarely matters at all. Guardian. This one, you could have like a barrier token or something. Tend to just like move the card up a little bit if there's like barrier. Okay, so then we have Shadow Isles. Shadow Isles has some created cards as well. First one would be over here. First one would be the Warden's Prey, right here. This one generates a random Last Breath follower and just have these Last Breath tokens. Showing this one. Another card that fell kind of out of the meta, but is still like relevant, is the Walking Shadows, at least in Expeditions, where you get an ephemeral copy. I just put down this ephemeral cards for it. With this one, like hand tracking is pretty important, because the ephemeral card goes on the right of the actual drawn card. And if they play like this card, then you know the card next to the ephemeral card, you know what the ephemeral card is. Next one would be Random Nightfall. This one is from the Unspeakable Horror. It's a random Nightfall card and have like these bicycle cards I really like. The Stargazer series and look like the Night. So I stand for Random Fall. And the last one is the Scribe of Soros. This one creates an ally that died this game and I have like this fiendish scroll. Showcases that it's like a Scribe of Soros card. You can like think about what they have, what has died already. Not a lot of those have like constructed applicability, but Ben City is constructed right now. That's why I started with the Ben City. Okay, the Shurima part. We have like not that many cards actually in Shurima. Most important one is the. Like, you can also keep track of champions. Shurima has the right of calling, drawing your champion, or the Allegiance card. Drawing your champion, if it's like they play the Allegiance card, I tend to just put a +2 on the champion. I know it's like buffed up. And then we have the landmarks. There are like a lot of different landmarks. This is what a landmark looks like for me. And cards that generate landmarks are first of all the Advance Imagine Possibilities, creating a random landmark. Then we have, most importantly, constructed the Bomber Twins, which generates a landmark that costs 2 or less. And I would just put a 2 on it, now it's like 2 or less. And we have the Talia Flip Spell, Stone Weaving, also generating your landmark. With Stone Weaving, I also keep track of how much mana they had over. Like if they played it with 4 mana left over, I put a 4 on it, so because I know it's a landmark with 4 or lower. The most expensive landmark is 6, by the way, so if anything more, then you can just put a 6 on it. Just leave it like that. Those are the only two face-down effects for Shurima. Another thing I like to do is with Narsus, I tend to just count how many units they have slain. Put a dice up here, 4, etc. And once they're at 4, you have to be aware of like Rampaging Bakai. One used to be very popular, now not that much, since Shurima is not in the best shape in Expeditions. But if they are like at 4 or more, then you can check. And of course, if they are like at 10, or like 8 is the critical number for Narsus, then you have to watch out for Narsus coming down and striking. And Sadly, it doesn't show that on the card, so you have to keep track of that. This is the last one and probably the most important one, which is Targon. And again, Targon has these Celestial cards, pretty powerful cards, and like, it's very important for example to play Poppy Satan Constructed if they have Aggressant Strike in hand. If they can have Aggressant Strike in hand, play Expeditions, you might be worried about Falling Combat or Supernova. Supernova in particular, if you know they have only have like Evoked twice, and they have like. I had like this play when they had a 2-2 on the board, Messenger, and they had only invoked one other card, and then they played Supernova. In response, I Mystic Shotted the Messenger, and the Supernova fizzled because it didn't behold a Celestial card anymore. This was only possible because you keep track of the invokes, and you know that they don't have any other cards like that anymore. Okay, so the Targon. The most important one are the different invokes. They're like different strengths of invokes. We have the super cool star chart, which invokes a 3 or less celestial. And I tried to draw the star chart image. It just looks like a stickman, but that's what it looks like in the picture as well. Then we have the invoke that costs 4, 5, or 6. So. That over here, you saw it before in the start of the video. It's like the priest is kneeling down and this invoke card. Then we have the star shaping basically, or the Aurelion Soul, being a invoke 7 or more. Tried to draw Aurelion Soul again, didn't pan out too nicely, but I get what this card is supposed to mean. Then we have the fully random invokes, like the Behold the Infinite. I just have the Behold the Infinite Eye or the fully random invoke. Another thing to keep track of is the Moon Weapons from Aphelios. Note that they are now revealed in the opponent's hand, because like you no longer see which Moon Weapon they chose, but the weapon goes into the hand. You don't know, however, which Moon Weapon they chose when they first created a Moon Weapon with Aphelios, or if they play Gifts from Beyond. I oftentimes see that, like random people just playing Gifts from Beyond and then never playing the Moon Weapon, hoping you forget about it, and then they run out this Caliburn at some point. It happened to me before, that's why I have a card for the Moon Weapon. Then we have Landmarks. There is a card listing called Divergent Paths, which draws a landmark. So if you draw a landmark in Targon, you can actually put down this one. More importantly, especially if you play against Lee Sin, would be the Steel once more. Is it written in stars? I have like a champion as well. The Targon Leaf with +2 on it if they played the written in stars. Another expedition favorite would be the Ravoon. This one creates a random Daybreak card, and I have the other half of the Stargazer cards with the sun on it. So it symbolizes a Daybreak. And the last one is a card I find really annoying that they didn't change it yet. It's just like Star Spring. Everything starts with Star. Star Spring. You should just make it like a countdown where it just clearly shows on the card how advanced it is, and it doesn't, so you like have to click on the landmark like every time something happens. I would just have this like Star Spring over here and would just put a dice on it, showcase how far this has advanced. This concludes all of the random effects, or like not random effects, but all of the created cards I keep track of. Some of those are not actually random, and want to have a summary of all of the random effects in the game, I have made a video about this one as well. A little bit different from this card pool. Some of the face down cards that are generated are not random. For example, the Lordless Squire is not random, but it's like a face down card you have to keep track of anyways. So I hope you have learned something about hand tracking in this video. And definitely hope you can follow along with my hand tracking. Again, if you're a new player, just study art expeditions, and well, if you like constructed below platinum, I would not advise you to focus too much on hand tracking because it's actually really distracting. I love to do hand tracking more if I like do co op runs when another person is playing so that I can like focus on this stuff and not have to worry about the rope or stuff like that. But it's definitely an asset to have, and I hope you can use it for games and improvement. Yeah. And I mostly do expedition content on this channel, but also some educational videos. I have like slides for all of the random effects in Legends of Runeterra. I have educational videos that apply to Constructed as well. I would appreciate if you could give this video a like if you liked it, subscription, and watch some other videos as well. Thank you so much. Check out Discord in the description below, and have a nice day.